genesis of Unicode was we started grabbing a lot of court records from one particular county, the Los Angeles Superior Court.
Unicode is also trying to democratize legal data. What does that mean, and what is it that Unicode is really trying to
do? Courts have to make this data available to the public by law, but how they make it available is a big gray area. So we try to make it more accessible by aggregating it, standardizing it, and structuring it so that it can be easily consumed. About a lot of transparency in the justice system.
Thank you so much, Prashant, for joining us today. Prashant is the CTO and co-founder for Unicode. Unicode is a legal tech solution that is mostly functional in the United States of America. They provide legal data as a service, which is something that we will be talking more about with Prashant to understand what that exactly means. However, a lot of their team sits out of India and particularly out of Mangalore. That's right, Prashant.
That is correct.
So in this very interesting setup, we thought it'd be best to speak to the man himself and understand how this entire thing functions. And more interestingly, we want to first start from the absolute beginning, which is that you were a computer science student, and then you, for some reason, levitated towards legal tech. So what was that entire transition about?
Yeah. Firstly, Shreya, thanks for having me on this talk. Computer science student, legal data, kind of goes back to, you know, how it all started, how Unicode all started. I did my engineering from a place called NITE here in Mangalore, close by to Mangalore. And I went on to do my master's in computer science at University of Southern California, USC in Los Angeles. Then I ended up actually working in the Washington, D.C. area for a networking software company where, you know, I was in the R&D division. After working for about 2.5 years, I decided to quit and start something on my own. So I came back to Mangalore and started looking for product ideas that I wanted to build. I had quite a few connections still back in the US, and you know, through some common contacts, I was introduced to Josh, who's now my CEO. Project which he wanted to kick off, which was collecting court records, legal data. And this was back in 2011, late 2011, right? When he described me what he wanted to do, you know, I sort of got together with a couple of my friends from the engineering side. This was the time when data is the new oil was kind of, you know, trending, started to trend. And when I asked my, you know, peers about legal data, they said, legal what? You know, so nobody had heard about legal data much. So I thought this is either a really stupid idea or a really big opportunity. You know, considering my, you know, I have a pretty big appetite for risk. So I don't think much when taking some decisions in my life. So I ended up taking up that opportunity, and, you know, ever since I've just fallen in love with legal data. It's been over 10 years now. So that's how it all began.
So that's great. But could you help us understand a little bit more how the idea of Unicode came up? And of course, like, I understand that data is the new oil, but can you help us understand what legal data is? And if you could help us explain, and if you could explain it like you would explain it to a 5-year-old, I think it'd be really helpful.
Sure. Legal data is, I mean, there are various data sets that come under legal data. Could be the case law, could be the court records, could be other public data sets like registration information of companies, SEC data. You know, it's quite a broad term. Ended up happening, for the genesis of Unicode was we started grabbing a lot of court records from one particular county, the Los Angeles Superior Court. And the use case at that point in time for Josh was he was running a debt relief company, and he wanted to market to defendants who were being sued for collection cases, which are credit card debts primarily. So he wanted to basically find out the latest cases that were being filed by creditors and these debt filers against individuals for credit card debt, so that he could market to them and sign them up as clients for his debt relief company. So we started grabbing court records from the Los Angeles Superior Court, started marketing to these individuals. And the idea was that these defendants had about 60 days before they could get an attorney to represent them from the time the court summons them. And our idea was to get them get these marketing materials to them even before the court actually summoned them, so that we could sign them up. That project was a huge success. So we pretty soon went on to collect data from San Diego, Orange County, San Francisco, all the neighboring counties. The marketing side of things for his company went pretty well. And at that point in time, me and Josh kind of sat down and said, hey, if this data can be used by us from a marketing use case, I'm pretty sure that if we started collecting all the court records, not just collection cases, there might be a lot of other businesses and other use cases that are out there that we don't know about, which we can tap into. So in 2014, we decided to form Unicourt and try to see what we can build and how we can sort of tap into that market of legal data to find out who actually needs this data. So that was sort of the genesis of Unicourt.
So this was initially very particular data, but I assume a lot has expanded from there. So what all other sorts of data sets do you look at currently, and what are the bigger market, footprints in terms of data in that sense?
Yeah, I mean, the name Unicourt was coined with an idea of unifying court systems and court records, right? And when we started grabbing this data and structuring this and making it available to our clients, we found a lot of use cases where our clients would use this data to enrich it with other data sets, other public data sets. So we took on that task to sort of grab other public data sets like Secretary of State data, which is the company registrations, right? Attorney bar data, right? So each state has its bar and attorneys get barred in there. So that's again another data set that we grab. The judge data, right? Law firm data, right? Law firms are notorious for changing their names so very often, depending on who their managing partners are. And to track that information as to how a law firm has changed a name over a period of time, we grab, again, the Secretary of State data, but specifically law firm data in there and try to map those things out. So there are a lot of public data sets that we have started grabbing over the years, because aggregation of public data sets is at the core of Unicourt. And we have seen that a lot of our clients find this very useful, because they don't have to integrate to multiple data sources to get different data sets. We sort of become a central place to not just get these data sets, but also to connect these data sets together.
So I have a couple of follow-up questions. One is, of course, I assume, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that the data sets for all of these various courts that you look at and various public records that you look at are not uniform. So I assume one of the biggest challenges that Unicourt faces is to just, simplify it in a manner so that it's actually comparable. One is that. Two, I also assume that, and this is particularly true for India, I don't know how it works for the United States, is that even in India, data on law firms is like, it's impossible to get, right? Unless you're in the know, or you know people, or you talk the talk and you do all of that, it's absolutely impossible to get any data at all. So the second question I want to ask you in that regard is that, how do you collect that kind of data, which is not really public data, so to say? And the third question is, you said that, a lot of your clients use it and enrich that data set and analyze it against their own data. So what is that kind of integration? And does Unicourt, become an enabler of integrating these two data sets?
Okay, let me try to remember the sequence of your questions. So first is how do we deal with unstructured data or data from different courts which are in different formats?
Different kinds of public records.
Right. So see, the first thing is that that's very true. Every court, you know, by law, this is public data, right? And courts are required by law to make this accessible to the public. But how they make it accessible is not very well defined, right? So each court typically has their own court management system, or an electronic court management system, ECMS is what they call it. And they have a front end, which is a website, which will be an ancient website. And the way you would access that data is not really easy for general public, right?
It's actually funny you bring it up, because very recently, IIT Delhi has like a new research center, which is looking at law and access to justice and, you know, all of that. And they did like an entire detailed study of the UI UX of 6 high courts in India. It's a very interesting read, I must say. But from your smile, I know what you're thinking, right? I mean, the obvious is very true.
Yeah, because, you know, that's not their primary focus. You know, UI UX is probably the last thing that they focused on. So the font, the way the content is laid out is not very intuitive. You know, if you're a lawyer and you're used to looking at that court site, yes. But if you're a lawyer and you're not used to accessing these, for example, a San Diego court versus a Los Angeles court, and you yourself will be lost, right? Trying to find the information that you're looking for. So we do grab the court records and standardize them. So, you know, no matter which source displays it in what manner and, you know, what nomenclature, right? We standardize those things and we structure it and store it in our system. So from court record themselves across courts, we first do the standardization, right? That's one of the first problems we try to solve in terms of structuring. The second problem that we try to solve is identifying a particular entity across cases and across courts. I'll just give you an example. Say John T. Smith is an attorney who files cases in Los Angeles, right? And you look at the case information, the docket information, mm-hmm. you'll see John T. Smith there, right? Now, the same attorney goes to the neighboring county, which is San Diego, files a case there. You'll see John Timothy Smith there, yeah. right? So that same attorney goes to Orange County and files another case. You'll see Smith, John T.
JT.
Right? Yeah. So, you know, there's no standardization, right? There's no standardization of the naming conventions. There's no standardization sometimes of even the case type. So that's the other problem that we try to solve, right? We solve that with AI, and that process is called as normalization. So we do named entity normalization, right? And so we try to identify the different variations of the name, the different, we try to catch spelling mistakes, which happen quite often, right? And try to identify these different variations of names that come in different court records across the courts, and try to associate just a text with the real world entity, right? Which is that individual or that attorney. And we do the same for law firms as well. Okay. And for businesses that appear as parties, right? Hmm. And to do all that, we use what is called as named entity seeding, which is using seed databases, or what is called as baseline data sets, hmm. right? And these data sets are basically your bar data of the entire universe of attorneys that have, you know, that have ever been barred. So whenever an attorney comes up in your case, it has to be one of the attorneys that come right. up from the bar, right? So we use that kind of a methodology. Okay? And the same happens for businesses that appear as parties in a case, for law firms that represent a particular case, and for the judges, right? So we have a separate teams that just collect these seed data sets. You know, their job is just to collect those seed data sets, so to enable this normalization. Now, the law firm information, you know, is actually public information in terms of, because it's typically a LLP, right? Or there are different other ways that a law firm can be registered. But this is public information because it goes into the Secretary of State registration. And the only problem there is, you know, each state has this data stored in different ways. Okay. And within each state, different types of registered entities are stored in different ways. So if you go to California, you know, you might get a C corp and incorporations in a one data set manner. If you want LLP data, you'll get it in a totally different data structure, right? And sometimes we even go to an extent of looking at the actual documents that were filed as part of a particular entity registration to figure out what was the actual name at the time of filing, right? So we do some amount of OCRing from the documents. We do data entry, which is a lot more easier, right, than trying to spend time to OCR the specific content from these forms, right? So this is public data, but it's hard to get, right? And the only reason, so we don't try to get everything. We only try to get what we can use to, you know, meet our client use cases. So that's how we try to limit the scope of these massive data sets. We have all those data sets, but to get real good information from those data sets, we try to reduce that scope, right? I think that answers your first two questions.
Yeah.
Right? you asked another question.
Yeah, which is how do clients make sense of your data, particularly using their own data sets, right? How do the two things tie together? And does Unicode play like an active part in that kind of conciliation or compilation?
Yeah, so, you know, most of the additional data sets that we grab and that we try to stitch together is based on client feedback. For example, clients come to us and say, okay, we want to look at court records for law firm ABC, right? And once we get that information, we want to look at all the parties that are involved in that case, businesses primarily, which have been represented by this firm, right? And for those parties, we want to look at, you know, what are their subsidiaries, right? If it's a publicly traded company, right? So what we see is that once clients pull our data out, they do a lot of work on their side, and we try to understand their use cases, and we see if it's fits our generic client base, and if we were to do that, does it add value to larger breadth of the clientele that we have? And we then pick up those projects and internally kick them off because it's it adds a lot of value to the clients because they don't have to do that on their side. They can just use our APIs and pipe the data out and get all the related information that we are building on our side. Right? Because, you know, they don't do it because they want to just stitch the data together, because they do it because they want to drive some business intelligence, right? Probably, you know, a law firm wants to start a new practice area, right? And it's in a particular state. So they try, if they want to figure out which are the top parties that are involved in that kind of litigation, to know which clients to now approach for that new practice area, they can get competitive intelligence on these kind of use cases. So that's where we internally kick off new projects to grab other data sets and try to integrate it with the court records.
Mm-hmm. Understood. So I'm just going to talk a little bit more about data, because since we're here at this topic, Unicode is also trying to democratize legal data. Right? What does that mean? And what is it that Unicode is really trying to do?
Yeah, I mean, and this goes back to the earlier topic of courts have to make this data available to the public by law, but how they make it available is a big gray area, right? So we try to make it more accessible by aggregating it, standardizing it, and structuring it so that it can be easily consumed, right? We feel that this data needs to be a lot more accessible because it can bring about a lot of transparency in the justice system. There are quite a few use cases where you can build profiles of businesses, profiles of law firms, profiles of attorneys and judges and their relationships and all of that. And the only way this can be done is if this data is easily accessible and structured in a manner which can be used to build on top of, right? And that's what we are trying to, that's what, when we say we are democratizing the data, that's what we are doing there.
Are there some data sets that you, after normalizing, also release as an open source data set?
All data sets that we grab are public data sets to begin with, right? The real advantage of normalization, so let me sort of put how normalization helps clients and how do they use it, okay? Say, for example, you are looking to get all cases of Bank of America, right? Now, your typical way you would actually do a search is like a Google search, right? You type in Bank of America and you would get all relevant results. Now, it does not necessarily mean that you're getting all results where Bank of America is involved, right? So this is more of a keyword or text-based search, right? Now, because of normalization, these simple text entities are now being converted into a normalized entity cluster, which has a unique identifier. So instead of just typing in keywords like Bank of America, which does not catch for name like spelling mistakes or variations in the name that have come up, this normalized entity would basically have all those things already resolved for. So instead of putting in a text, now you're putting in a unique identifier for that entity to get all related cases of that particular entity by leveraging Unicode's normalization, right? And whatever data sets that are associated with that normalized entity is something that you can access using APIs as well. Right. So all public data sets that we internally use to do these different things, we expose all of those data sets to the clients, because it's not just the higher level picture that the clients are interested in. You know, once they look at aggregate information or analytical data, they all clients want to drill down and get into the actual data source, the actual cases and the underlying data sets. And we provide all of that information through the APIs.
Okay, understood. And just going back to how Unicode currently functions, right, which is across continents, can you perhaps help us understand how that works? And is that something that's very common in the legal tech space globally?
Yeah. Is that very common is a tough question to answer, because the whole reason we are able to, I manage the technology side of things, right? We are about 90 plus engineers here and 120 plus, with other functions put together. Now, Josh, my CEO, manages the business side of things, the sales, the marketing, and even the product and the domain knowledge. Now, the only reason we operate this way is because our relationship started this way. I know of a few companies that operate, that have their primary revenue model in the US, and have certain back offices in Mexico and even in India, right? Their technology side of things, primarily. Okay. So I wouldn't say it's common, but you will definitely find a few companies which do this, either because their relationship started here, or lesser because of their relationships began that way, but it was more of a conscious decision they took as part of scaling their operations and teams.
Right. And since a large part of Unicode is in India, right? I think we've spoken about this before, but just for the benefit of everybody else, what is Unicode's part been in the Indian market? And is it an active choice to not engage a lot in the Indian market?
Keeping an eye on the Indian market for quite a long time, but we have never actually given it a thought in terms of do we want to enter the market? But when I built the architecture for Unicode, I made sure that the architecture can scale.
Fungible.
Yeah, scale countries or continents, mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of grabbing the necessary data sets and doing that first layer of structuring. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the data pipeline just follows, including normalization and analytics and all that. But what we have seen is even you for just focusing on US market is a big task. Mm-hmm. And we have decided to pick only one battle at a time.
Sure.
US is the primary focus, but we don't have any plans of entering the Indian market at this point.
I see. So apart from that, perhaps if you could just help us get a better sense of your take on the Indian legal tech market versus the US market, and Are there any learnings or models or ideas that you think we can really, you know, sort of bite into that's happening in the United States already?
You know, my understanding of the Indian legal tech or Indian legal market for technology is very limited to a few people that I talk to. But one thing I always hear is that, you know, lawyers and law firms don't want to pay for technology solutions. That's just what I hear. Now, I don't know how far it's true, but that's what I hear. But, you know, having said that, I know of a couple of companies in India which are doing pretty well in the legal tech space. Like there's one called, I think, Spot Draft. Mm. And a couple of others as well. But not at the scale at which we are seeing you know, in the US market. You know, we see a huge number of legal tech startups now coming up, even getting funded, even getting acquired. And we are in the US, we are seeing a lot of sort of consolidation happening, you know. Kira Systems got bought over.
Right.
So Lightera Micro is doing quite a bit of acquisitions. Yeah, Infotrack is doing quite a bit of acquisitions. So there's a lot of consolidation happening in the US, which means there is sort of cross-selling happening and there's a lot of interest there. But I haven't seen that kind of, you know, it's not happened in the Indian space yet.
And generally in your experience and in your various exchanges with the legal industry, right? Generally, do you think we're averse to change, or what are the general tendencies you see that are a little that usually tend to hamper tech adoption in the legal industry?
There's a lot of demand for legal data. Okay, a lot of enterprises, whether it's law firms, whether it's insurance companies, or for that matter, even other new age sort of AI companies that do, you know, person profiling, that do individual profiling and all that. You know, court records are one of the primary data sets for them, right? We have seen a lot of companies try to come to us and, you know, wanting to use the data, right? Because they have a lot of internal use cases. But they underestimate the amount of effort that is required to really get the intelligence out from this data integrated with their internal data sets. You know? A lot of our clients have been successful because they have dedicated that time, money, and effort in terms of putting the right resources in to do that work. And some of them have just tried to, you know, tried it out like a proof of concept, a side project, which has never worked. The amount of value that can be derived from data is definitely huge, and it is sitting there. The only question is finding the right kind of people to harvest that information and utilize it, and putting the necessary resources behind it. And that is where we have seen the gap, right? So it's just a matter of, you know, having that sense of realization that it takes a significant amount of time, money, and effort to get the value out of it.
I think that's the same thing with just investing in technology to begin with. For you to start reaping any benefits, it takes enough amount of time, especially with change management involved and people involved and so many moving parts involved. Yeah. So I'm just going to come loop back to Unicode. And I understand that one of the basic models is actually crowdsourcing as a business model. What does that mean exactly? And how has it helped you tap into the legal tech space?
Yeah. This requires a little bit of understanding on how these data sets are made available by courts, right?
Okay.
US has, you know, at the federal courts level, US has what is called as PACER, Public Access to Electronic Court Records, right? PACER gives you access to all the district courts, the appellate courts, bankruptcy courts, and a few other courts, right? Where sort of the big litigation happens. Now, the way they make this data accessible is, it's a PPC model, pay-per-click model.
Okay.
So you have to, every time you click on a docket report, you get charged, right? It could be anywhere from 10 cents to a max of $3. And if you refresh that page, you get charged again, right? Now, you know, one thing that lawyers and our customers look at is the docket information, but more importantly, they are always interested in the documents, right? And the documents are also charged, right? Each document is charged anywhere between, again, 10 cents to $3, depending on the number of pages that are present in that document, right? Now, what we do is, you know, although this data is charged by that portal, there's no law on redistribution of that data once it's downloaded, right? So we have a concept of a crowdsourced library, right? So if any customer looks at any of this data, which is to be paid for, we just pull that in and put it in our crowdsourced library. It could be documents or it could be docket entries, so that the next person looking at that data doesn't have to pay for it, right? And you know, Pacer is a good example of where every single thing that you see is literally charged for. Okay. Now on state courts, it's a whole different story, right? You have state courts, you have each county has its own court site. You know, there are about 3,000 counties in the US, and about 65% of them are digitized. And each court system has its own methodology of how they make that data available and whether they charge for it or not. So for example, if you go to a Los Angeles court site and order a document, it could charge you anywhere from $1 to $40 for one document, again, depending on the number of pages. So what we do is anytime a customer of ours orders any of the paid information, you know, for that matter, even free information, if they look at it and they update that information from the court, we put all of that in the crowdsource library so that the next person doesn't have to pay for it, right? So that's how we have built the crowdsource library. Mm-hmm. Now, it's not really our primary business model, but it's just the way we have built Unicode, saying that, you know, you benefit from the entire user ecosystem that is building in Unicode. Right? That's the idea behind that crowdsource library.
Okay, understood. All right, thank you so much. And we're going to move away from Unicode a little bit to talk about the other things that you're involved with. One is that you started the hacker space in Mangalore, and you're also part of the Karnataka Digital Economy Mission. So depending on what you choose, we can pick it up from there.
Yeah. So Hackerspace Mangaluru was an initiative I started with a couple of my friends and colleagues, where we wanted to build a sort of a tech ecosystem in Mangalore. Mangalore is considered, Mangalore is an educational hub. So people, there are about 23 engineering colleges here, over eight plus medical colleges. Okay. You know, people from all around the country come to Mangalore to study, right? But as soon as they finish their education, everybody's out, right? So you have about 12 to 15,000 engineers that come from this small place, and everybody's just gone out, right? So what we are trying to do as part of Hackerspace Mangaluru is we invite the tech companies from Mangalore to come in and give tech talks. We conduct a lot of workshops. We bring in speakers from other cities, right, to come in, and we hold sort of day-long tech events where we invite students, professionals, and everyone to gather together, and slowly trying to build that ecosystem, right? This is, since COVID, we have not been doing this because we like to meet people in person and hold these events because it's also about networking and spending time. We hope to kick that off pretty soon, you know, in hopefully once things settle down with COVID.
Well, good luck for that. I'm actually going to take a short segue just to understand, you know, for you, do you think community building is very important? Because Hackerspace Mangaluru is like a community in that sense, right? And for you, in your professional life so far, have communities helped you?
Yeah, I think community building is extremely important. You know, you especially if you are in, it's true for probably any domain or industry, but if you're in technology, if you're not building a community, oh boy, you're in trouble. Yeah, because technology changes so fast. Mm-hmm. And if you're not learning from others who are adopting technology in different ways to understand what's trending, you know, what's what is the market moving towards, then you're going to get left mm-hmm. behind, right? And if you're left behind on the technology front, I mean, you're in trouble. Okay. So, you know, having this community has actually helped us help Unicode quite a bit, because we have learned from others as to what type of technologies to adopt, how do we go cloud native? How do we improve our internal development and deployment processes to achieve efficiency and increase our productivity? And at the end of the day, that's what matters for a tech company, right? How fast can you churn out features, right? How fast can you build new features? How fast can you grow? Mm-hmm. And building these communities has definitely helped us to learn a lot from each other.
Okay. And if you could also talk about a little bit about the Karnataka Digital Economy Mission.
Yeah. So Karnataka Digital Economy Mission is actually a Section 8 company that's formed by the Karnataka government with the industry. And we have some great people heading this this company. The mission is to align with the Prime Minister's mission of making it a $5 trillion economy, right? And how can Karnataka contribute towards it? Mm-hmm. There are several initiatives that are run in Karnataka Digital Economy Mission, and it's called as KDEM. And one of those initiatives is Beyond Bengaluru initiative. So what Karnataka is doing now is they identified three clusters in Karnataka: Mangalore, Mysore, and Hubli. And the idea is that to build the IT and digital economy in these clusters. And there are special incentives from a policy standpoint that the government is making, and even from a branding standpoint that we are doing, where we are trying to grow the IT and ITES industry in these regions. And as part of doing that, I'm part of the advisory panel for Mangalore, in addition with three others from this region. And we are actively involved in promoting Mangalore as part of this.
All right, great. Thank you so much. So I'm going to now move into getting some life and tips and tricks about just, having run a legal tech startup. So if I am somebody who wants to get involved and get more engaged in this space, right, where do I begin? Like if I am, let's say, a law student or an engineering student for that matter, and I want to get engaged in this really hyper exciting buzzword kind of a space, where should I begin?
I've seen some legal tech companies in India. If you're talking from the Indian side of things, right? There are a few legal tech companies in India that have started, and most of these startups nowadays offer great internships. Mm-hmm. So, I feel that every law student, not a lawyer, actually, you should start this when you're studying. Every law student should try to intern at a legal tech company, and I'm pretty sure legal tech companies would be happy to onboard them. Okay, but you should because you get a sense of how technology can be adopted, right? So if you do that from your student days, then you go and join a law firm tomorrow. You can make recommendations in there. So you lawyers can be advocates for adopting technology rather than legal tech companies trying to sell it to lawyers. I think that's one way to look at it. From an engineering standpoint, for legal tech is probably one of the, or I should say, legal or law is probably one of the last sort of industries that have where technology has not penetrated yet, right? So most of them might say, "Hey, then it's probably not a good time to touch it yet." Okay, but I see that as an opportunity, right? If somebody is staying away from something, then that's an opportunity. Okay, so more and more engineers should definitely give a hard look at this for one primary reason. I think legal tech is one of the few spaces where you will find a lot of data. Okay, now we live in a data world, there is a vast amount of public data, legal data that is available out there that people can start testing out. Okay, I'll just give you an example. It's not uncommon for engineers to go where the hype is. Okay, I'll give you an example of health tech, right? So health tech is pretty big. FinTech is pretty big. Health tech is pretty big. I've seen students trying to pick up projects on health tech where they try to go and collect data literally in paper, okay, from hospitals, and then anonymize it and to work on it. Now, as students, you might not want to do that, right? You might want to work on data sets that are readily available. And actually, legal data is there's plenty of legal data out there that you can work on. Okay. And the best part of it, it's public. Okay.
Hmm.
You know, people would say, oh, but I don't know law. I don't know, you know, at the end of the day, it's just data. It's just a matter of spending some time and understanding the nomenclatures and what is what. I think if you think about it that way, and if this, hopefully more and more people see this, and then we'll have more and more people.
I'm actually intrigued because isn't like healthcare data or anything that's related to medicine equally complicated in terms of jargon?
Probably more.
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably more. But there's a lot of, you know, hype around it, right? And I don't think there's enough hype created around legal data or legal tech in general. Primarily because there's not enough market opened up yet for it. Okay. I think once lawyers decide to pay for technology, probably there's going to be a demand and there's going to be a hype and there's going to be a market. But it's not necessary that lawyers or law firms are the only consumers of legal data. You know, whether you like it or not, every individual or every business is bound by law, right? So legal data has actually a much wider significance if you think about it. It's just a matter of time before it's, you know, before people start realizing that and start working on it more and more.
I absolutely agree because every company has to manage legal risks and just general compliance risks. So to that, and you can't run away as much as you'd like to during college. Yep. Okay, so just moving to the second stage, let's say, okay, now I'm out of college and I'm now trying to start a legal tech company or something in this space, right? What are the three things I should definitely keep in mind? And what are the three things I should completely avoid? And that can be even generic advice.
In the principles of startup remain the same no matter which industry you're in, right? Like ideation, prototyping, building an MVP, putting it in front of a first customer, getting feedback, then iterating over it, right? I think that applies to any space and more so for legal tech space because you better know what you're building. Okay? And hopefully there's a market for it, right? And you won't know until you release at least 10 to 15 features out to know which one actually clicks and people are ready to pay for. So the general sort of theme does apply. But one thing I would say in the legal tech space is three things: patience, and patience. I've seen over the course of time, it's not easy to sell to lawyers or law firms. You know, the average sales cycle for us for a law firm is anywhere between 12 to 18 months, right?
Oh, okay.
Which means if you have to demo something to a client and if you're a startup, you're already put your money in to build that MVP, right?
Yeah.
And after you demo it, for them to adopt, it's going to take them 12 to 18 months. So you better have enough cash in your bank.
Yeah, I was going to come to. Most startups don't have that kind of runway money.
You don't, right? That's why you see a lot of failures too. Because the adoption is slow. Okay. No matter how much hype is around the startup, okay, the adoption is still just because your startup is hype, that doesn't mean somebody's going to adopt you faster. Okay. So you need a lot of patience. And in legal tech, I think that is really important. That's probably also because it's, when you think about legal tech, you're only thinking about lawyers and law firms. Okay.
Mm.
And that's how we had started, in fact. We said, okay, you know, let's tackle the small to medium size law firms, try to do a mass sell of Unicode, which never really worked. So then we had to, you know, pivot, change our strategy and go and try to sell to other industries and then law firms, larger law firms and all of that. So you just have to figure out where your market is, how are you going to enter the market? And that takes time and there's no shortcut to it. Right? It just takes time. So you need patience.
And is there any smart way perhaps to do that without burning your entire runway money? Like, is there a way to perhaps slice the product and get like dissected review or anything? That's just off the top of my head.
Um, I mean, I'd like to know if there is Vivian. that would be like the holy grail in legal tech. It depends on the segment of the customers that you're trying to target, right? If you're a practice management software, right, depending on who you're targeting, what would you define to be an MVP for an adoption purpose, right? There might be, if you sort of narrow down the scope to a very specific targeted segment, right? To say, this product is for personal injury attorneys who run, 5 to 10 attorney firms, just for them, right? To see what the market is. And then from there, you try to probably expand to other practice areas. You know? Because, we are not in that space, but what I've heard is that each practice area, each department typically has their own version of a practice management software for their practice area. Right? Probably narrowing down the scope to a limited audience and trying to target them might be a better way of knowing whether what you have built actually has value to them or not.
What I'm hearing is not go for, just appeasing the masses, but pick your battle one by one and then go from there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Even with us, the problem was, so we are a data company at the end of the day, right? Mm. And the problem with a data company is that you have a lot of data, right? So you have all these ideas that keep popping out saying, let's do this, and this. But if you don't focus your thoughts on, okay, what is the one thing that we are going to do right? Then you have a big problem, right? Because you'll be sort of master of none and jack of none, right? Narrowing down what you really want to do from an idea perspective and from targeting the market definitely helps you understand whether what you're doing, whether the market is going to accept it or not.
Like a sales perspective, what kind of pitches really resonate with, let's say, a lawyer in an in-house department, or now you even have Fortune 500 companies who are looking at your data. So what really resonates with these three different kind of stakeholders?
Typically, my engagement with sales is when there are technical questions that keep coming up, right?
Sure, yeah.
That's typically handled by our sales department and my CEO in terms of the touch point to sort of nurturing the lead. But, when clients come to us, there is a specific need that they have, right? So it could be process automation of their firm or could be an insurance company. It could be business intelligence that they want to derive, right? It could be competitive intelligence in terms of the clients that they want to do, right? So it's different things. It just depends on the business and the priority at that point in time that they come to us. It's just that they know that we have this data, we have it well-structured, and they can do something with it. The question is, internally, are they ready to put the money behind it to make it useful and derive value from it so that they can prove to their management that there is an ROI on that, right?
Yeah.
So that's my sort of experience so far.
Sure. All right. I just have one last question because we've been talking for a while, which is, you've started Unicode and now it's been 10 odd years and perhaps a little more. So where do you see yourself going from here? Do you continue to be a data company, or are there bigger plans that you have? What is it that we can all look out for?
When we started Unicode, the idea was unifying court records. My CEO George is a visionary, right? He likes to think about things that are not even practically possible, right? Which helps us set really high goals. But we want to be a public records company in general, right? And where we sort of want to fit in is be the one-stop shop for all public records, and not just accessing these records in isolation, but accessing in a highly connected way to get a lot of value from it, right? So as part of realizing that vision, what we are doing is, since the inception of Unicode, we are internally have kicked off a project called the Apollo project, where we are re-architecting the entire technology stack, and we are taking the API first approach. So Unicode will be an API first provider, and you know, our app that we build will be built on top of our own APIs, right? So as part of that, because we want our users to also access all the data that Unicode's app is accessing as well, so they can get to the raw data, right? As part of that, you know, I think our alpha release of those APIs are going to be out next month, and we are going to have 145 APIs, right, with 190 plus structured objects. So this has been 18 months in the making in terms of design and implementation, right? So this is a pretty massive project. And I think this is going to sort of set us, you know, prepare us for where we want to head next, which is becoming the provider for legal data in the US. So I think that's where we are heading right now.
Okay, that, all of that sounds very exciting, and good luck for whatever is to come yet.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Prashant, for all your time. And thank you for speaking to the audience in such a frank manner. I'm sure it's going to be very, very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Shreya, for having me, and always a pleasure.